Assalamu alaikum, everyone. I want to welcome you to another installation of the Zoom In on the Halal Metropolis project. We're trying to document and call attention to all the things that the Muslim community in the Metro Detroit area is doing to cope with COVID, to contribute in a period of COVID. And today I'm very happy to have with me Rena Elmir, who's the acting director of the ACLU Michigan. Rena's a longtime activist in terms of civil rights across the board, immigrant rights, working here in Michigan. And it's a real pleasure to be talking to you again, Rena. How are you doing?
Thank you, Sally. It's so great to be with you today.
How are you and your family doing with COVID?
Alhamdulillah, everybody is doing well. Parents are vaccinated, and so that weight has been lifted, feeling incredibly privileged and grateful.
Alhamdulillah. Yeah, every time I hear of anyone getting the vaccine, it lifts my spirits just a little bit. But yeah,
absolutely.
Definitely when my parents and when my in-laws got it, I can't wait to get it myself so I can get in my car and go see some people I haven't seen in a year. So
Absolutely.
So I think you had an editorial recently in the Free Press about the travel ban and what needs to be done today to not just rescind the travel ban, which President Biden has already done, but to try and heal the wound that was created by it. Tell me what your thinking is on this issue.
Yeah. Well, first, I always like to start with the celebration, and I think there is a lot to celebrate when it comes to the Muslim ban. As you said, the Biden administration, as one of their first acts, and that. We can't overstate the importance of the fact that rescinding the Muslim ban was one of the first acts of this president. And of course, rescinding one of the first acts of President Trump as well. But the reason I want to celebrate is not because of what these presidents did. It's about what the activists did and the advocates in our community. It's about those airport protests. It's about those rallies at the Supreme Court, demonstrations in the streets of Detroit. It's about the fact that so many went into court to defend themselves and their families. It's about those who told their stories to the media or testified at Congress to talk about the real harms of the Muslim ban. And of course, when it was expanded to include more African countries as well. And, we have a lot to celebrate, and we should celebrate all of that. However, that's not where we stop. Rescinding the ban is not enough. It's a huge, huge first step. However, we have two opportunities now. And we can't just roll back time 4 years and say that's enough. We've learned a lot of lessons in the past 4 years, and we want to act on those lessons. And so there's two things I think we can do as activists, as community members, as advocates. One is to support the No Ban Act. The No Ban Act is just really essential addressing the harms of the Muslim ban. And not only does it address the Muslim ban, it also addresses the asylum ban and the refugee ban as well. And what it does is it puts a stricter standard in place for when the executive branch, when the president can restrict people from coming into a country. And that is essential because we can't treat the Trump presidency as an anomaly. We have to organize and legislate for the next Trump presidency. And so we need those stricter standards in place. But what the legislation also does is it puts in place a checks and balance for Congress to be able to monitor, be notified about implementations of future restrictions. And when I talk about that higher standard, what I want to be sure to identify is right now, under current law, the executive branch claims that they have broad authority to prevent large swaths of people from coming into the country. What we want and what the No Ban Act does is it says that you have to actually have credible facts, actual evidence. You have to have specific acts that actually occurred in order to restrict individuals from coming into the country, as opposed to what the Trump administration did, which is to use fear mongering and discrimination as a proxy for those things.
Can I just add one thing? So it's not to restrict individuals, it's to restrict whole national communities. I think that's the issue. It's like, the problem isn't that, I mean, there might be good reason to restrict individuals, and those individuals, as you're saying, if it's evidence-based, that makes sense. But this was just a mass generalization about a huge part of the world. So I just want that one little word, individual, I had to step in on.
Yeah, no, that's such a good point, Sally. And that's what under current law, that's what the president, that's the power of the president, that's the power that Trump claimed to have, which is to prevent large swaths of people, entire peoples, from coming into this country. And then finally, what the No Ban Act does, and it gets to the point you were making as well, and that is it prevents discrimination based on religion to be a part of that consideration, which is huge, right? We know that people were banned from coming into this country simply because of their religion.
Absolutely.
And national origin just became a proxy for religion. Yeah.
Well, so in addition to supporting the No Ban Act, which I agree with you is incredibly important, and I also understand that we have to put a lot of bumpers in place. I'm thinking my bowling to keep things moving next time we have a rogue administration like the last one. But in addition to that, to supporting the No Ban Act, what else can people do right now?
Well, you're absolutely right. We just as we can't just, you know, roll back the clock 4 years, we can't also just look at the future. We have people who were harmed yesterday. We have people who were harmed a year ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 4 years ago by the Muslim ban and the expanded Muslim ban that included and targeted African countries. And these are people who were denied their visas for no other reason other than their religion. Let's be really clear about that. They paid their fees. Many of them went on long journeys to other countries in order to be able to go to an American embassy or consulate in order to, because they thought they were going to be able to move forward with their interview process and move forward with their visa. And so, and then we can't forget the fact that there are many individuals, particularly many in our Yemeni community here, right here in Michigan, who won the golden ticket of visas, and that's the diversity lottery visa. Mm-hmm. This is a visa that is given to individuals from certain countries where there's not a ton of immigration and there's not many ways of coming to the U.S. And so there's a process in place that essentially your number is picked, and it is truly a once in a lifetime opportunity. Mm-hmm. Those people are also harmed. Those people were also banned. And so as part of the rescission of the Muslim ban, what President Biden did was he asked for a report from the State Department to talk through some of these impacts and implications. And that report is actually due on Saturday.
Great. Yep. So we'll put a link to it with the interview.
Absolutely. Hopefully it's actually out by then. You never know the bureaucracy of it all. But what we want to see in that report is a path for people who were previously denied to have that path reopened. And for me, that means, or for us, it means that we want fees waived if you've already paid your fee and have been denied, again, simply because of your religion through the Muslim ban. We want visa applications to be expedited, mm-hmm, for those who are denied. And we want, for those who are denied, we want that denial to not be used against the individual. So we don't want the previous denials to be a part of the calculus for why someone would get denied into the future. And of course, for those whose number was called through the diversity lottery visa, we need this administration to really look, bring those folks to the U.S. immediately, because they would already be here if it wasn't for the Muslim ban. And so, you know, for us, there's an opportunity right now to make these individuals whole again, and we have to take it, and we have to use every tool at our disposal to do that.
Yeah, and I think I would include in that list people who had family members who got stranded in a third country, and they spent, you know, their life savings trying to just support these people waiting for their visas. Some of them did eventually get into the country, but it took, you know, 2 years longer than it would have otherwise. So I think that there should also be compensation for citizens who got put through this unjustly. I also want to ask about the Syrian community, because I know that the refugee program, I mean, they were one of the groups that was blocked. You know, just in a really dire situation. Both Yemen and Syria are among the world's greatest humanitarian crises of this particular moment. And I'm just wondering what is being done now to, are we going to, I know that Biden set the refugee resettlement number for this year at like 125,000, which is what it was under Obama, the last years of his presidency. But I'm wondering if we're going to lift that cap to compensate for the fact that, or if that's something that people are advocating for, to compensate for the fact that there were 4 years where we weren't able to play our traditional role in the world.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, lifting that cap is essential, but I'll tell you, the Trump administration devastated the refugee resettlement program. And that program is going to have to get back up to speed. And that's going to take some time. So if you look at all of the steps a refugee has to go through, medical exams, biometrics, getting their paperwork in place, many of those items actually have an expiration date. And so someone who got all of their stuff together 4 years ago or 5 years ago may have to do some of those things again. And you put on top of that COVID and the way the pandemic has really limited the capacity of the immigration system to work as it did 5-6 years ago. We have a lot to work through. Certainly lifting the cap would be helpful, but we need to get people into the pipeline first. And right now that pipeline is broken.
Yeah, so we need to get the people in the pipeline, and we need to restaff the pipeline itself. And then here, I know that the refugee resettlement agencies in Detroit, they laid off most of their staff because they had no work to do. So we need to get those groups up and running again too. It's the amount of work involved is just, it's unbelievable. it's a huge task.
Yeah.
Well, so there's one other issue that I wanted to ask you about really quickly, which is there's talk of new legislation in Congress, anti-terrorism legislation that's intended to fight domestic terrorism. And it's being articulated as something that's going to be used to give the FBI new powers to fight white nationalists. I'm just wondering what your take on this legislation is.
Yeah. So, Sally, I have been talking about this for many years. And the short answer is I personally and the ACLU oppose such legislation. And for many folks, that might seem odd, right? Why don't we want the FBI to have all the power, all the tools at their disposal to fight white supremacy? Well, the truth is we can't use a white supremacist system in order to combat white supremacy. And in fact, this system has been used against our communities disproportionately. The FBI and any other federal law enforcement agency and local law enforcement agency have everything they need to fight white supremacist violence in our communities. What they don't always have is the will. It's not about new laws. It is truly about the will. And what you have is a country that has disproportionately looked at Muslim communities, brown and black communities, in this kind of law enforcement national security framework, and have allowed white supremacist violence to run almost unchecked. And so what we need is to fix the will piece, because it's certainly not about the way. And I'll give you an example here. Some years ago, the ACLU of Michigan, we worked on a case in which a gentleman was he was charged with bioterrorism for getting into a fight with his neighbor and biting his neighbor. This is an individual who is HIV positive. And so his body was weaponized, according to the government. This is not what our terrorism laws were meant to do. But again, it's not about the way, it's about the will. And when we allow law enforcement agencies to use such laws, they tend to use them against marginalized communities, Black communities, brown communities, LGBTQ communities, disproportionately. We've seen it time and time again.
Yeah, and it's even in the, you know, the way they define things as terrorism. You know, if there's a Muslim suspect involved, it's just terrorism. You know, they don't have to do any more explaining. Whereas if it's a white person or, you know, then they really bend over backwards to try and explain why this isn't terrorism, why this doesn't qualify. Whereas I think what the ACLU has been saying all along, what I've been saying all along, is that, you know, it's terrorism is crime. Use your crime powers to fight it. You have all the tools you need in your crime toolkit. Calling something terrorism doesn't help solve the problem, you know?
Yeah, we need to, as a country and as advocates, we need to begin dismantling the anti-terror framework that has harmed our communities. That is where we should put our efforts. We don't want to add to that framework, because we know that has been used against us. I don't trust that it'll actually be used to combat white supremacist violence, because it never has been. And
history of that. There's a long history of white nationalist, you know, terrorism. And you're absolutely right. We've run out of time. I hate to rush you, but I can't thank you enough for taking a few minutes to share all this news with us about what's going on and about the activism of the ACLU. And we're very excited to have you in charge here in Michigan, if only for a little while. But you've been doing a great job all these years. We've been watching your work and are real fans of what you do. And I just thank you. And I want to tell everybody in the audience, I want to thank you for joining us. And if you have a story that you think we should be covering in this series, please let us know. Just please reach out to me, send me an email. And I will provide links to the different things that we talked about today on the description of this talk, so you can follow up yourself and learn more about these issues. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us, Rena.
Thank you for having me, Sally.